things. The camera adds 15 pounds, but I just received a text from one of our precious church members that said, "This is the darkest I've seen your hair in about 5 years." And so there is a silver lining to things, is there not? Look a little bit younger than I probably do in person. I do want to tell you, before we get rolling, before we get into things, that this sermon is PG-13. So you just need to be aware of that. If you have small children, this would be the time to dismiss them to your own version of kid life, which means the backyard or their room. Though, if you are willing and able, let them sit and listen as well, because it will be, I think, practical to them too. I encourage you, if you haven't already, go ahead and grab a mug of hot coffee, unless you're like Michael Clark, who despises the delicious gift from the Lord. You can go ahead and get some hot cocoa, or I don't know, orange juice, whatever you drink in the morning. Grab your cushion and join me in Matthew chapter 5, verses 27 through 30. The sermon this morning is entitled "The Lure of Lust." And that's why it's PG-13. We are continuing our series through the Gospel of Matthew. Last week, Pastor Glenn helped us see the deep roots of anger in our hearts and how to combat that with the gospel. And today we're going to look at the lure of lust. If you're taking notes, like Allison Goins did last week, shout out to you, well done. Here is the sermon in one sentence. So you can listen to this and then log right off. No, I'm just kidding. Sermon in a sentence. Here it is. Lust is adultery of the heart and must be aggressively fought, because a life that embraces it will perish in hell. Let me say that one more time. Lust is adultery of the heart and must be aggressively fought, because a life that embraces it will perish in hell. Now, I know you may be thinking, Josh, that's a little intense right off the bat, like I'm sitting on my couch now. But if you think that sentence, the sermon in the sentence, is white hot or red hot, just know this passage that we're about to look at is white hot, and it comes straight from the lips of our Savior. So let's look there together. Matthew chapter 5, verses 27 through 30. Jesus says this in the Sermon on the Mount. He says, "You've heard that it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body go into hell." Now, my sermon this morning has 3 points, because I'm a good Baptist. And those points are as follows. First, the saying. Second, the heart. And finally, the battle plan. So let's look at the saying. In verse 27, when Jesus says, "You've heard that it was said," he's actually referring to and commenting on the teaching and the so-called righteousness of the Pharisees and scribes. See, the Pharisees and scribes were obsessed with external obedience, outward obedience to the Old Testament law and to the traditions of the elders, which we've talked about in the past, is the laws that were built upon the Bible and upon the scripture to keep us from actually disobeying the Bible. They were obsessed with it. And Jesus says that this group, they have said, "You shall not commit adultery." And they're right. Here's the news flash. That comes straight from the Bible. It's the 7th commandment. And it's very straightforward. To commit adultery, we're not to do. A married person is not to have sexual relationships with someone other than their spouse. In Old Testament times, adultery was treated very seriously. Listen to the words of Moses from Deuteronomy 22:22. He says, "If a man is found lying with the wife of another man," that is, if a man is found having sex with the wife of another man, "both of them shall die, the man who lay with the woman and the woman." And here's why. Here's the point. "So you shall purge the evil from Israel. I mean, I think it's plain enough that we know we should not commit adultery. In fact, I think even those with the most seared conscience knows that adultery is an act of relational betrayal. We know this. It's destructive. Right now, I'm reading a book by Christopher Ashe entitled Married for God, and Jared Adams and his fiance are reading it as well. And in his last chapter, chapter 6, he lists 6 reasons why adultery is so serious. I want to tell you 2 of those reasons and then add 1 of my own. First, Ash says, adultery is a serious sin because it hurts the spouse and the children. When adultery occurs in a marriage relationship, trust is broken. It's broken. A spouse has been betrayed. What God made for the purpose of those two in that covenant has now been taken outside of the marriage bed, and destruction follows. I mean, it's simply betrayal. It's heartbreaking for the spouse. But then we think of the children. The children are especially hurt when adultery occurs in a marriage because generally adultery leads to a family breaking up, living in different homes, sharing different weekends and weeks, sharing different holidays. The children didn't ask for it, but they received the full force brunt of the pain. Ash says in his book, adultery is a serious sin because it breaks up families. It hurts the spouse and the children. The second reason he says it's so painful is that it destroys the one who commits adultery. I mean, think about it. Like all secret sin, adultery eats away like a poison at the heart of the one who commits it. It tears apart the integrity of that person. It damages their relationship with the Lord. It damages their joy in the relationship they have with the Lord. It introduces betrayal into your legacy, and it's secretive. You know, when a marriage is on the horizon, and it is shouted from the rooftops, save the date cards, hit the postage, on Facebook, the engagement and the proposal is made public. It's posted in videos. It's a celebration. It's out in the light. But adultery, well, it's the exact opposite. I don't recall the last time I received a postcard in the mail from a husband who had said, hey, I've been unfaithful to my spouse, just wanted to let you know. No one advertises their treachery. It's because marriage enjoys the light and adultery prefers the darkness. So Ash says adultery is a serious sin because it destroys the one who commits it. And I just want to add, adultery is a serious sin because it's an act of defiance against God and it is a willful betrayal of his good design. I mean, think about this. Marriage is intended to tell the story of Christ's faithful love for his church and his church's faithful, loving obedience to him. And so, to those who have stepped out of that bounds, when a husband steps beyond the marriage bed into adultery, it's like he's telling the world that Christ could fail the church, which is utterly impossible. Or when a wife steps beyond the marriage bed into adultery, it's like she's telling the world that the church loves idols more than Christ himself, which is willful defiance against God. I just want to speak plainly for a moment to those right now who are tempted toward this sin. Maybe you've been feeling drawn toward another person. Maybe you've been considering how you deserve a little bit of sexual indulgence. Maybe you've been dabbling or toying or playing with or lingering with this sin. Maybe you feel intrigued at the possibilities of adultery. If that's you and you're listening right now, hear the word of the Lord. Solomon writes in Proverbs 6, 27 through 29, he says, can a man carry fire next to his chest and his clothes and not be burned? Or can one walk on hot coals and his feet not be scorched? So is he who goes into his neighbor's wife. None who touches her will go unpunished. This enticement you're playing with is a false promise. Fire is great in the fireplace. But when you bring fire into the bedroom, it will consume the house. Sex is a great gift in marriage. But when we take it beyond the bounds of our marriage covenant, the wake of pain it leaves is unimaginable. So the saying was, you should not commit adultery. In our actions, we should be pure. But then in verse 28, Jesus goes from the saying of the Pharisees that came from the Ten Commandments that had to do with our outward obedience to the heart of the command. Look at Matthew 5:28 with me. It says this, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Jesus now turns us from the action to the heart. When he says, but I say to you, Jesus is showing himself to be the perfect interpreter of the Old Testament law. I mean, here's the deal. The scribes and Pharisees didn't have the authoritative word on the word. Only Jesus, the true son of David, did. And what he does is he gives us the intent or the heart of the command. He says, the one who looks at a woman with lustful intent, it's him who has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Which means this, adultery isn't just a physical act. Adultery is something we can do in our heart or in our mind. If we were to define adultery of the heart, it would be this. It's having impure sexual thoughts or desires for someone who is not your spouse. Again and again in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus confronts us with the truth that the heart of the matter is a matter of the heart. He confronts us with the truth that we cannot clean ourselves up. Can you just look in the mirror for a moment? Every one of us have broken the heart of the commandment. Every one of us. The seventh commandment, we have not kept the heart or the intent of it. Which means this, we need his rescuing power. We need Christ's transforming spirit within us. We need a new heart, a pure heart. Purity is not merely about outward action. It certainly is about that, but it's not only that. It's also about our internal desires. As Jesus said in Matthew 5:8, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. I wonder, have you been given a new, pure heart by God through faith in Christ? You will never win the war against the lure of lust without a pure heart that's only granted to you by faith in Jesus Christ. I want you to think about it for a second. The Pharisees, remember Jesus says, but I say to you, now he gets at the heart. The Pharisees were proud. Because, well, they stayed out of bed with other women that weren't their wives. They were proud of it. And to that pride, Jesus looks at them and says, you know those lingering looks that no one notices? Yeah, that's your heart in bed with other women. And that will corrupt you. That has corrupted you. That is adultery of the heart. I don't know if you know this, but you don't have to be married to struggle with the sin of lust. It's inclusive. It welcomes everyone into its trappings. And lust is serious because lust is progressive. It grows. It starts small and then grows. I think of a snowball at the top of a mountain. You push it down and it grows and grows and grows. You know, back in 2006, a year after I graduated, there was an Army major who adopted a four-month-old hippo and named him Humphrey. Humphrey lived on his 400-acre farm, and he grew big and strong, and he learned to swim with humans. In 2011, the Army major took a selfie with Humphrey riding on his back, and he wrote in his newspaper, and I quote, "Humphrey's like a son to me. He's just like a human. There's a relationship between me and Humphrey the hippo, and that's what some people don't understand. They think you can only have a relationship with dogs and cats and domestic animals, but I have a relationship with the most dangerous animal in all of Africa." You know, just a few months after that picture was taken, the Army major was found, his body ravaged at the bottom of a river that ran through his farm. That shouldn't shock you. I don't think any of you are amazed, because it's crazy to raise a notoriously dangerous animal as if it's docile and tamed. But I tell you that because, well, that's what we do spiritually with sin. And then we snuggle up to our sin. I think about the sin of lust. We attempt to tame it. Starts small and seems cute, so we think, but then it grows up to destroy us. James speaks of this in James chapter 1, verses 14 and 15. He says this, "But each person is tempted when he's lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it's fully grown, brings forth death." This is what James says. When you lust in your heart, that desire gives birth to a baby known as sin. And sin, when it roots down and when you take care of it and when you feed it with a bottle and you let it, allow it, and embrace it into your life, it grows up and becomes a father. And it has a baby known as spiritual death. And that spiritual death, church, well, that spiritual death is condemnation in hell. See what happened to the army major because he adopted a harmless hippo? Will happen to us spiritually if we embrace and adopt harmless lust. We have to get rid of it. We have to realize that the sin of adultery always begins in the heart. It begins in our mind. It means it begins with a lingering look or flirtatious conversation. It begins when we stop loving our spouse and we begin lusting for another. You know, when we think about the sin of sexual sin and the sin of lust, man, it can be frightening. Man, what are we to do? How are we to fight against this seemingly all-encompassing sin? Well, Jesus gives us the motivation in verses 29 and 30 from our text. Let's look at this as we see our last point, the battle plan. Jesus says this, "If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body go into hell." Now, Jesus gives us the motivation for our battle plan. And what he says is this, we must get radical in our fight against the lure of lust because the consequence of coasting is eternal. We must get radical in our fight against the lure of lust because the consequence of coasting is eternal. And just so there's no misunderstanding, Jesus is not being literal here. He is not literally telling you to rip out your eye and throw it in the trash can or cut off your hand and throw it away if it's causing you to sin. He's using hyperbole. What he's trying to help you see is this is important. Take note and get serious with sin. Because if you embrace it, the consequence could be eternal. Now think about it. We feed the beast of lust in our life a lot of ways, but one significant way is through our eye, which is why I think Jesus said, if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out. So if we want to think about how we feed this beast, some of you are feeding the beast right now through social media profiles you troll. Some of you are feeding the beast of lust through the sexual material you digest on YouTube. Others of you, even through outright pornography that you take in. Some of you are feeding the beast of lust through your inappropriate locker room talk. Gets in your heart, gets in your mind. Some of the inappropriate things you say. Others of you are feeding it through some of the apps that you have. I know teens are especially vulnerable with apps like Snapchat and others. Certainly can be great tools used for awesome communication, but also the devil's playground. So we must be careful. Some of you just let lust run wild in your mind and in your imagination. If you're a lady, maybe you're feeling at this moment, I don't really struggle with lust. It's not really a big problem for me. Let me ask you, do you add fuel to the fire of a man's lust? By the way you dress, are you dressing to arouse or be noticed by another man, that their eyes would linger on you longer than they should? The almost all-encompassing nature of sexual material that's within a click of you and your children's fingertips is frightening, and so we must get radical in our fight against the lure of lust, and for any sin for that matter. Paul told the church in Rome, in Romans chapter 13, verse 14, he said, "Make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires." Are you making provision for your sin? Are you making a bed for your sin, letting it come into your home and grow up to devastate? Let me give one word of general advice, and then I'll end with a battle plan. General advice, this right here is an amazing tool. It's incredible. But if you struggle with the sin of lust, this is also like a spiritual handgun. Parents, if you let your children go into their room at night with this, I am telling you, you are creating in your children unknowingly a battle that they will face the rest of their life, and that is an addiction to pornography. Amen. I just want you to think about this for a second. If there was an alcoholic who went in his room at night, poured a glass of scotch and put it by his head, all of us would say, "You are stupid." Giving this to a kid, a teen, and letting them have this unattended, alone in their room, I'm telling you, you are creating a battle that their spouse will mourn over in the years to come. So make no provision for the flesh. Like, be wise, be smart, fight, prepare yourself. Okay, my word of advice is over, and here's the battle plan. Let's talk about how we starve the beast. In our student ministry, we've been studying Tim Challey's visual theology. And Pastor Trent, just a few weeks ago, last time we met, walked us through kind of the pursuit of the life of a Christian. And that is the pursuit of stopping sin and starting habits that create godliness. If you think about the Christian life like a garden, the Christian life is a life of pulling up the weeds, that is sin, and planting vegetables, that is godliness. Paul would say, flee sinful desires and pursue righteousness, or take off the old man and put on the new man. So I want to give you a battle plan, and it's a two-part plan. The first is stopping. We have to stop sinning. Our part in this, in stopping sinning, is first, we look in. I want you to evaluate whether the sin of lust in your life is especially deep-rooted. Like right now, in your mind, on a scale of 1 to 10, how deep-rooted is the sin of lust in your life? Once you've figured that out, then you need to look in and begin to fill yourself with the weight of the horribleness of your sin against God. You have to realize that your sin is ugly before the face of God, so that you can then begin to look up. It's the second part. We look in and evaluate and fill our life with the ugliness of our sin, and then we look up so we can long for deliverance from God. See, I think so often we hasten that step and we begin to look up because we really just want the earthly consequences of our sin gone. And we don't realize the cost of our sin, which is our Savior on a cross. And when we realize the consequence of our sin, we begin to long for God's deliverance. And then, man, we can meditate on God's word as we look up. Meditate on his promises, the fact that he's a good father who loves his children, who embraces them, who is kind and merciful, who holds them close even when they sin, which we all do every day. But he's also a holy and just God who won't let sin go unpunished. So our sin is either dealt with on the cross in Christ, or it's dealt with in eternity, in hell. So we look in and then we look up so that we can look out. Once we've felt the refreshment of God's forgiveness and his transforming power in his life, now we can begin to plan against the fight. Consider, do you lean into the sin of lust? If you're a man, and you're listening to me right now, look me in the eyes. You don't need to consider this. You struggle with lust. Okay? No considering. You do. If you're a woman, here's the deal. Ask yourself, do you struggle with the sin of lust? It's something you need to consider. Are you prone toward this sin? Once you've figured that out, then you can begin to contemplate when you're at your weakest. So maybe you struggle with the sin of lust late at night. Maybe it's when you're hungry or bored. Some of you struggle with this sin when you're tired. And one of the most godly things you may be able to do is get a good night's rest so that you're not tempted with the sin of lust in the morning. And so as we look out, we begin to think about when we're most vulnerable to the sin taking over, then we have to covenant to battle. We have to agree that we will never, ever allow ourselves to toy with this sin. Job said, I have made a covenant with my eyes that I may not look at a virgin, gaze at a virgin. The very moment you feel this sin rising up in your chest, right, is the very moment you battle. Like I tell the boys in youth group, when you feel that, when you get that feeling down in your bones, you need to go for a run. You need to take a cold shower. Some of you need to have sour candy. Put it in your mouth, right? We need to battle radically. And when we do this, we can expect God to deliver us and then speak peace over us. Let me ask you this question. Who wants you freed from the lure of lust more than God himself? No one. And so when you covenant to battle, you look in, you look up, and you look out. God is battling for you. He wants you to win, and he wants to speak peace over you. But think about it. If you're a gardener, you pull up these weeds, you get rid of this sin. If you don't plant something, evil will grow up in it. So we must also plant godliness. We can't just get rid of this sin. We can't just fight it without planting virtue. And the virtue that we need to plant, what we need to do is replace this sin with love. We replace the lure of lust with the fruit of love. If you're a single, I encourage you, man, love God hard. Love him hard. Read his word. Meditate on his promises. Spend time with him in prayer. Come to church when we're able, and meditate upon him, and then love your neighbor well. If you're married, you should do the same, but you also have one more tool in your tool belt, and that is sex. And so I just want to encourage all my married people out there that you should work to tend and nourish your sex life in your marriage. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, by faith we find out that sex is actually a tool against Satan and his temptations. And so God invented sex. He created it for our enjoyment in biblical marriage. And so we should replace the sin of lust with love of God and love of neighbor. And if you're married, with a good, healthy sex life. Now, as I conclude, our part in this fight is to stop and to start. To take off the old man and put on the new man. To take off lust and put on love. And we must get radical in our fight. Here's the bottom line. Sin brings forth sin. And sin unchecked in your life brings forth spiritual death. The lure of lust, and you know this well, is powerful. I mean, Jesus, in this passage, he brings heaven and hell into discussion when he talks about lust. In essence, Jesus says, get radical in your fight against lust, because if you coast, the consequence is eternal. If you're listening right now and you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, I want you to tune in for just a moment. The lure of lust in your life is just a symptom of the real problem you have. It's just a symptom. The real problem you have is that you have a sinful nature. That by nature, you're rebellious against God. And what we've seen from our passage is that rebellion against God, unattended, leads to eternal consequence. Sure, you could try to manage lust. You could put together this battle plan that I've given you and really try to manage lust in your life, and maybe your marriage will be better, but your eternity won't. It just won't. It's only when you begin to see this sin clearly, to see your nature clearly, and then lean into the arms of Jesus that you will be given a pure heart. I encourage you to look to Jesus, to trust in Jesus. Read the Gospel of Matthew, read the Gospel of Mark, and see who Christ is and allow his word to transform you. Have you found forgiveness and salvation and the cleansing power of Jesus? You can do that. You can do that right now by recognizing your sin and trusting yourself to Jesus. That's your part this morning. Don't just battle your sin, get at the heart of it. Go to the actual root, and that's to Jesus, and he will rescue you from it. Here's the gospel promise that we have, Christians, in Jesus. That in Jesus, we are actually and already free from the bondage of sin, and we're slaves to Jesus. And our fight is to oddly live in what we already are. You're called to live that out. Christian, if you're bound up in the lure of lust, don't wait to get caught. Repent before God and tell your mom. Repent before God and tell your spouse. Do what's right. Listen to the words of Jesus. Heaven and hell hang in the balance. Listen to this final promise. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, Paul says this to the Christians. He says, I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. So our part in this fight against the lure of lust is to stop that sin and to start habits that create godliness in us. That's our part. But here's the reality. We rest in the sovereign hands of God, who began the work of holiness in you at salvation, who upholds the work of holiness in you right now, and who will complete the work of holiness in you on the day of Jesus Christ. And it's in his hands we rest ultimately. And so, Christian, you can rest in that as you fight the lure of lust. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word that just penetrates and speaks to us so plainly, so openly, and so honestly. God, I pray that we would live lives of spiritual love. We would bear the fruit of the Spirit of love by your Holy Spirit, that we would not get caught up in the lure of lust, that we would fight that we would covenant to battle against it so that we could live a life of righteousness that you call us to. God, we thank you that you are upholding us in this battle. God, that you are faithful to complete the work that you've started. God, I pray that your word would work in us today. God, that it would take root in us. Father, we love you and we praise you for it. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Church, I want to thank you, and those who aren't a part of our church, I want to thank you for joining us this morning via live stream. I look forward to the day we meet back together, but until then, just know next week, again, we will live stream. We'll continue our series through the Gospel of Matthew, which means remarriage and divorce. So it'll be a tough passage, but God is good. Thanks for joining us today. And if you need us, we're just a phone call away. We love you. God bless.